This is the A. Crosby Kennett School, and it's located in the small town of Conway, New Hampshire. As you can see, the columns are being painted because Kennett is about to celebrate its 75th anniversary. That's right. On June 19th, 1999, people from all of the small towns in the Mount Washington Valley will come together to celebrate the graduation of Kennett's 75th class, the last graduating class of the 20th century, and my senior class. As I look towards my graduation and the milestone it passes in Kennett's history, I can't help but wonder what life was like for kids in years past. There truly is something very intriguing about the old days. I think it has to do with the clothes. They look more like costumes than what you would wear every day. And the hair. Who wears hair like that? I have the feeling that I missed something by being born in 1980 instead of 1940. Maybe it's an innocence that disappeared during the Vietnam era, or maybe it disappeared when TV became the only thing that people turned on so they could tune out. At any rate, it would be great to go back in time, but since that's impossible, the next best thing is to watch a film made right here in Conway 50 years ago called The Conway Boy. It was produced by the State Department as a part of the Voice of America program and distributed in European countries to tell the story of the typical American boy's life in the late 1940s. And thanks to the Reverend George T. Davidson, Pee Wee French, and all of the students from Conway and the sending towns, the life of a typical student in 1949 was beautifully portrayed on film. The first time I watched this film, I was so happy to see Dave that's what we call him, George Davidson. In fact, that's what everybody calls him. Dave has been a major player at Kennett High School for most of its history. He was a teacher, a coach, and the director of guidance, and the headmaster. Dave no longer works at Kennett, but he can still be found watching a baseball game or just taking time to connect. Everyone loves Dave, and everyone always has. You could say he's the man. As I looked through old newspapers and yearbooks, it was clear that Dave had some pretty outstanding colleagues, and together, they took very good care of Kennett kids, especially when life dealt them a bad hand. And thankfully, that kind of dedication hasn't changed with the times. Kennett has a lot of great educators who have our best interest at heart. They lead by example when it comes to working hard, show us patience when we struggle to learn, and they go the extra mile, even in the face of limited resources. Maybe like other traditions at Kennett, dedication is something that gets handed down with each new generation of teachers. Watching The Conway Boy really brings home that saying about the more things change, the more they stay the same. Pee Wee French, the main character in the film, is pictured here on a mountain describing to a pen pal who lives across the world the beauty of Mount Washington Valley. The scenery is just as beautiful now as it was then. You can see the most beautiful view from Kennett's very own backyard. I wonder if I'll be able to see anything like this from my college dorm. I wonder if my college dorm will even have a window. The reason Pee-wee is writing to his pen pal is that Dave, who was his headmaster at the time, thought it was important for kids from the small towns in Mount Washington Valley to connect with the rest of the world. He told the student council, and I quote, "It doesn't matter where you live, but the way you act towards the rest of the world is very important." Educating kids about tolerance and acceptance comes naturally to Dave. It's his calling card for anyone in need of a kind word or a friendly smile. Today, instead of writing to pen pals, we have email that lets us transmit communication with the touch of a button. I bet that people who lived in Conway in 1949 would have laughed at the notion of communicating across the world in an instant. Internet access and email capability really are quite amazing. Just like the Student Council of 1949, Kennett's current Student Council is comprised of representatives from each of the four classes, and they talk about things that concern the entire student body. Today's agenda includes organizing volunteers for the upcoming blood drive, grade point averages and class rank, and changing the student handbook so that it works for us, not against us. The student handbook dictates the rules of life at Kennett and spells out the consequences if rules are broken. The student council feels that a few of the rules are not only unfair, but actually hinder the learning process. The administration has invited a student council representative from each class to serve on the handbook review committee to discuss the things we would like to change. Changing the rules is never easy, but the process lets people share concerns and ideas. when people take the time to really listen to each other, solving even the biggest problem becomes pretty easy. My favorite part of the Conway Boy is when Pee-wee takes us through his school day.
School buses come in from all the towns around Conway, and I look for Eddie Ashnault.
It's really amazing how similar life is, except, of course, the hair thing. Another thing that has changed significantly is the building itself. To say that this building has experienced some growing pains is an understatement. To get an accurate history on this, I relied on a little help from my friends, David Emerson of the Conway Historical Society and Bruce Kennett, the great-grandson of A. Crosby Kennett. In 1922, the Conways were having some serious educational problems. Townspeople thought that costs were too high and the high schools were overcrowded. With the offer of money to build a new school from the Kennett family, the town was able to open doors to a new facility on September 10, 1923. In 1938, two wings were added to the original structure, and the 7th and 8th grades moved to Kennett in the fall of 1939. By the mid-60s, the enrollment at Kennett had grown, and the facility was, once again, overcrowded. So the town voted to build a second addition, and in 1965, Kennett opened its doors to an improved and expanded facility designed by Frank Kennett, an accomplished architect and the grandson of A. Crosby Kennett. In 1979, the junior high wing, along with extensive renovations to the existing facility, were completed. In 1980, Kennett added the vocational center and a new gymnasium. Conway and the sending towns have come full circle regarding the school's physical plant. Costs are high and the building is overcrowded. I think that is where the story began back in 1922. The kids pictured here are part of a generation that John Fuller, superintendent of schools in the 40s, charged with the duty of changing the world. At least, those were his parting words to the class of 1945. I got the following passage out of a 1945 yearbook I found in the Kennett alumni room. "Upon you falls the duty of rebuilding the world on a new pattern of security and universal freedom. You will need the strength that is born in faith and the good that is in all men of every race, creed, and color." The destruction of World War II was, unfortunately, something John Fuller knew only too well. His son, Sam Fuller, was killed in action in France in 1944. Sam not only attended Kennett, he was a teacher and a coach before he went into the service. Many families lost sons to World War II and came upon difficult financial times. But that doesn't stop people from remembering the post-war years as the good old days. People had less money back then, but they had more time. We often use the expression that time is money, but time is not money. Time is precious, and when you take the time to take care, life is good. Just ask members of the Kennett Key Club. With support from some pretty special Kiwanis members, students spend hundreds of hours doing community service. The small-town nature of the Valley makes us realize how much we count on each other, and kids really do want to be part of the solution. We get a lot of recognition, especially from the local newspaper, which, by the way, is always scorned, but very well read. Being recognized for good work makes us feel appreciated, and it's great when people take the time to notice what's been accomplished. While there are many people my age who have lost their way, there are plenty of kids at Kennett who make it their business to make our world a better place. And sometimes we even manage to have fun in the process. Check out this fundraiser for the local chapter of Dollars for Scholars. Now, here is some good old-fashioned fun, and what a great way to unwind after a long, hard day of classes. As you can see, snowball fights are still a great way to end the day. Some things never change, or maybe they do. Another thing that hasn't changed is the after-school hangout. It was called Stone the Druggist back in 1945. Today, it goes by a different name, but it's still a great place to kick back and have a laugh or two. I think television literally hadn't been introduced in Conway in 1949. So instead, people spend a lot of time at the movies. It's interesting that Pee-wee French had to assure his audience that he and his friends knew the gunfire in their favorite westerns wasn't real. Obviously, parents worried about kids watching violent movies in 1949 just like they worry about it today. I guess adults have always worried too much about what we watch at the movies, and not enough about what we watch them do. A long-standing tradition at Kennett High School are the school dances. Pee-wee couldn't explain what was going on at his dance to his pen pal, because he was pretty clueless about it himself. If Pee-wee was confused about the social dynamics in 1949, what would he think today? Our world is certainly less inhibited, a bit more daring, but romance lives. One thing that has remained a constant here at Kennett is the dedication to sports. Some people think that learning happens only in the classroom. I don't agree. Coaches have helped us to develop self-discipline, build character, and grasp the value of teamwork. These are qualities that will help us make the most and the best of the knowledge we get in the classroom. When Kennett opened its doors in 1923, it only offered football, basketball, baseball, and cheerleading. But school spirit and good sportsmanship were as important to the program then as they are now. Here is a quote from the 1925 Kennett Comet, written by Clarence Davidson, a member of the class of 1926. School spirit is something all pupils should have. It can be shown in many ways. A fellow or girl with a well-developed body should take part in all athletic contests for the benefit of the school and himself. Besides learning to play the game, there is the possibility of meeting many people and a chance to see interesting places. While playing in athletics, it is best and most honorable to play square, regardless of circumstances at that time. A school with a good reputation is sure to be received more quickly than one which has a doubtful record. It is a wonderful feeling to be cheered on an out-of-town floor and to know that the audience is expecting a true sportsmanlike contest. The smaller or underdeveloped fellow or girl who is not able to compete for athletic honors can show his spirit and belief in his school by going to all school affairs and by cheering heartily at the athletic games. These are ways of showing school spirit. Today, students of all body shapes and sizes are competing, participating, and winning in a multitude of athletics. Take cheerleading, for instance. Since before Pee-wee's time, and up to the early 70s, cheerleaders weren't really considered athletes. They didn't even have a coach. But today's Spirit Squad is governed by the same code of athletics that governs all other team sports. We not only have a coach, but we participate in several competitions around the state. In doing some research, I discovered that during the first 50 years, five men steered Kennett through some glorious years of sports history, and in many ways, we continue to benefit from their contributions. Ellis Mack McKean, for whom the football field was named, was Kennett's principal for 24 years and an enthusiastic supporter of athletics. Glenn Coach Stearns was an inspiring coach and a teacher for whom the football clock was dedicated in 1975. Carl Crush Seidensucker is remembered for his enthusiastic leadership on the football field and on the basketball court. The Kennett Gym bears his name. Gordon Mann, a teacher and coach revered for his integrity and remembered fondly for his dedication to Kennett kids. And last but not least, George Dave Davidson, for whom our baseball field is named, because he is Kennett's own Mr. Baseball. Now that is one heck of a spirit squad, if you ask me, and their spirit guided Kennett sports to where it is today. And where is it today? Well, let's just say that we have a few more sports and a few more kids. Allison Purnell and Sidney Clawson were standout tennis players in the 80s and 90s. Sean Kenny, class of 1999, is the best boy high school tennis player in the state of New Hampshire. Coach John Judge's teams have been the state champs three times. Basketball has always been an exciting sport at Kennett. The first season of girls basketball in 1923 proved to be an overwhelming success, with the opponents never getting out of single digits, and Kennett scoring over 50 points in each contest. Another memorable year for basketball was 1942, when Coach Crush Seidensucker led the boys' basketball team with their talented Rudy Lorraine to win the Class B championship. The last boys' state championship team was in 1961. While the state championship victories may not have piled up, the list of 1,000-point scorers is 9 deep.
There it is.
90%, 1,000 points. The best point guard that I've ever seen at Kennett High School. All the skills. 4-year starter, Trevor McDonald.
He's got to block it out.
Oh, nice defense by Diane Provincher. That's Kristen Avila, and that's 1,000 right there, baby. Congratulations, Kristen Avila.
Hey, did you know that the leading point scorer for Kennett is a girl? That girl is Deb Russell. Coach Bob Russell, Deb's dad, led his 1989 team to win the state championship. Girls rule just in time for the 90s. Kennett now has both boys and girls soccer teams. John Skelton, one of Kennett's noted soccer coaches, is remembered for teaching his athletes that a good player makes himself look good. A great player makes his teammates look good. How many times have we heard we should use our heads? Just another example of how sports teach life skills. This year, Kennett's field hockey team beat their long-standing rival, Kingswood, during the regular season for the first time in a number of years. That was one sweet victory. And speaking of hockey, up until this past winter, kids had to do battle with Mother Nature when they wanted ice time with a home court advantage, just like the kids in 1949. Thanks to a lot of special people and hard work, we now have the Ham Arena and a home for Kennett hockey. The girls' softball team is usually pretty strong, and this year is no exception. Our last state championship was in 1994, but by the end of this season, that statistic could change. The senior coach at Kennett is baseball's Bob Burns, son of former big leaguer Jack Burns. Coach Burns led teams to state championships in 1974 and 1995. In April of 1999, he gave Kennett's varsity team a very memorable experience. He arranged for a regular season game to be played in the place where baseball was born, Doubleday Field in Cooperstown, New York. Families and friends made the 7-hour road trip for the pleasure of seeing them play on the field where many of the greats have played. What a fitting way to honor and celebrate 75 years of Kennett baseball. Don D.T. Trimble organized Kennett's first official track program and during the first 12 years won 90% of their meets. What makes D.T.'s and later Coach Bernie Livingston's successes all the more amazing is that Kennett doesn't have a track. In fact, Kennett's track team has the distinction of spending more miles on the road than Jack Kerouac. Cross country became a team sport in 1964, and since that time, it has had some impressive runners. This has always been a ski town, but getting up the mountain today is a little faster and more efficient than it used to be. Pee-wee would have thought that these were aliens, not skiers. But Kennett skiers are a force to be reckoned with. They run gates, sail through the air. And race on the flat. Our ski teams have quite a few state championships under their belts, and they certainly make us proud. Coach Bob Fisher, racing phenom daughter Abby, and Olympian Tyler Palmer are champions that Kennett will surely never forget. Last, but certainly not least, is our glory sport, football. Football at Kennett is a tradition that commands respect. Check out these pictures of Rudy Lorraine and Brad Bemis. During the post-war years, Navy Surplus supplied Kennett with uniforms. Tommy Hilfiger, move over. Many successful teams have produced good, and in some cases, great players. You will notice on the 64 All-State team, the Kennett Eagle is Earl Palmer, and to his right, number 74 is our very own athletic director, Lou Deloge. He's from Franklin, but we won't hold that against him. Gary Millen has led our football team for 21 years. He was once quoted in the newspaper as saying, "I've never been one to say winning is everything. All I ask is that they do their best." And that is a philosophy that has brought an amazing amount of success for Kennett football, including 6 state championships in 8 years. Sometimes it all comes down to the coaching. The values that we have learned and practiced in sports are the kind of lessons that will carry us through life. You don't have to take my word for that fact. All you really need to do is look at the number of successful athletes and coaches who have made important contributions to the school and community. In fact, the Alumni Association created the Kennett Sports Hall of Fame in 1991 to honor outstanding citizens, former coaches, and students who demonstrate the rich tradition of good sportsmanship and strong competitive spirit. The Hall of Famers are the ones who have shown us how to be humble winners and graceful losers. They're the ones who make Kennett a school worth remembering. I've been looking forward to graduating from Kennett and moving on for what seems to be such a long time, but just when that's about to happen, I'm not sure that I'm ready to leave. It's like all those lectures about how I shouldn't wish my life away or I shouldn't try to grow up too fast start to make sense. But the joke is on me because, guess what? Now it's time for me to grow up. In just a few short months, I will go to college where the only one who knows me is me. Now that's a scary thought. But for the first time, I'm realizing that it will be a little lonely without all my friends and all the other familiar places and faces. It's like I'm truly glad for where I've been all my life, and I think I just figured out where I've been all my life. But there is one more thing I need to say. It has never been more clear than it is to me at this moment how all of the generations of people from years past, as well as the present, have contributed to the life and experiences I have had here. No matter where I go or what I do, I will be forever grateful for this small town and for all of the people who have made life at Kennett so special. And by the way, if you're wondering who I am, just call me the Conway Girl.
Still haven't seen enough to say look who's in the big town.